どういうことですか、ドラマ。あ、スタート。ओके वेलकम टू दिस लाइव सेशन स्टूडेंट्स। क्यों
লাইভ সেশনে স্টুডেন্ট থেকে কোনো ইন্টারঅ্যাকশন আসবে না, ওরা লিখিত ইন্টারঅ্যাকশন দেবে,
ওহো
ভয়েস আসবে না, আপনি ওদের
ওহো
গুলোকে কন্টিনিউ করুন।
ওকে ওকে হ্যাঁ, সো উই হ্যাভ গট সাম ফিউ কোশ্চেন্স অলরেডি হুইচ ইউ হ্যাভ গিভেন ইন দ্য এক্সেল শিট, সো আই উইল স্টার্ট ফিউ। দ্য ওয়ান কোশ্চেন দ্যাট আই হ্যাভ গট ইজ রিগার্ডিং পোলারাইজেশন। দ্য কোশ্চেন ওয়াজ হাউ ক্যান উই আইডেন্টিফাই টাইপ অফ পোলারাইজেশন বাই ইউজিং ফেজার ডায়াগ্রাম, হাউ উই আইডেন্টিফাই লেফট অর রাইট সার্কুলার অর এলিপ্টিক্যাল পোলারাইজেশন। ইফ ওয়েভ ইজ ট্রাভেলিং ইন এক্স ডিরেকশন দেন হাউ উই ফাইন্ড ফেজ ডিফারেন্স, দ্যাট ইজ ডেল ওয়াই মাইনাস ডেল জেড অর ডেল জেড মাইনাস ডেল ওয়াই। নাও উই স্টার্ট উইথ দিস। ফার্স্ট আই ওয়ান্ট টু সে দ্যাট প্লিজ নোট দ্যাট পোলারাইজেশন অ্যাকচুয়ালি ইজ এ টাইম ডোমেন ফেনোমেনা, মিন্স ইউ উইল হ্যাভ টু ফাইন্ড দ্য লোকাস অফ দ্য ই ফিল্ড ভেক্টর ইন টাইম। ফেজার ডায়াগ্রাম ডাজ নট গিভ দ্যাট, দ্যাটস ওয়াই উইল সি দ্যাট হোয়েন উই ডিসকাস পোলারাইজেশন উই নিড দ্য হোয়াট ইজ দ্য টাইম ডোমেন পিকচার অফ দ্য ই ফিল্ড ভেক্টর। সো ইউ ট্রেস আউট দ্য ই ফিল্ড ভেক্টর উইথ টাইম অ্যাট এ পার্টিকুলার পয়েন্ট অ্যান্ড দেন ইউ সি হোয়াট ইজ দ্য পোলারাইজেশন। সো দ্যাটস ওয়াই দ্য স্টুডেন্ট হু হ্যাজ আস দ্যাট বাই ইউজিং ফেজার ডায়াগ্রাম হাউ ক্যান আইডেন্টিফাই, ইউ ক্যানট আইডেন্টিফাই। নাও দ্য কোশ্চেন ইজ দ্যাট ইফ, প্লিজ রিমেম্বার দ্যাট ইফ ইফ ইউ সি দ্যাট দ্য ওয়েব ইজ ট্রেসিং আউট, দ্য ওয়েব মিন্স দ্য ই ফিল্ড ভেক্টর ইজ ট্রেসিং আউট উইথ টাইম অ্যান এলিপস, দেন ইউ উইল সি দ্যাট, সো ট্রেসিং আউট মিন্স আইদার ইট উইল বি ট্রেসিং আউট লাইক দিস, দ্যাট মিন্স দিস ইজ দ্য ক্লক ওয়াইজ রোটেশন, অর ইট উইল ট্রেস আউট অ্যান্টি ক্লক ওয়াইজ রোটেশন। দিস ইজ দ্য মোস্ট জেনারেল থিং। নাও ইফ দ্য ওয়েব ইজ ট্রাভেলিং ইন মাইনাস জেড ডিরেকশন দেন দ্য ক্লক ওয়াইজ রোটেশন ইজ কল্ড রাইট হ্যান্ডেড অ্যান্ড দিস ওয়ান ইজ কল্ড লেফট হ্যান্ডেড। ইফ দ্য ওয়েব ইজ ট্রাভেলিং ইন প্লাস জেড ডিরেকশন দেন দিস উইল বি অপোজিট। সো সিমিলারলি ইউ ক্যান হ্যাভ ইনস্টেড অফ জেড ডিরেকশন, সাপোজ দ্য ওয়েব ইজ ট্রাভেলিং ইন এক্স ডিরেকশন। নাও দিস পিকচার ইজ রিটেন ইন দ্য প্লেন হুইচ ইজ পারপেন্ডিকুলার টু দিস ডিরেকশন, সো ইফ ইট ইজ জেড ডিরেকশন ওয়েব ট্রাভেল আইদার প্লাস অর মাইনাস, দিস ইজ অ্যাকচুয়ালি এক্স ভার্সেস ওয়াই প্লেন। ইফ ইট ইজ এক্স ডিরেকশন ইট উইল বি ওয়াই জেড প্লেন, সো ইট উইল বি ওয়াই জেড অ্যান্ড দেয়ার ইউ ট্রেস আউট। সো দেয়ার এগেন ইফ ইট ইজ মাইনাস এক্স ডিরেক্টেড দেন ইউ সি দ্যাট ইফ ইউ হ্যাভ ওয়াই জেড অ্যান্ড ইফ দ্য ট্রেসিং ইজ ইন দ্য ক্লক ওয়াইজ ডিরেকশন দেন ইট উইল বি কল্ড রাইট হ্যান্ডেড, আদারওয়াইজ ইট উইল বি কল্ড লেফট হ্যান্ডেড। সো দিস ইজ অ্যাবাউট দ্য সেন্স অ্যান্ড ওয়েদার ইট ইজ এলিপ্টিক পোলারাইজেশন অর ওয়েদার ইট ইজ সার্কুলার পোলারাইজেশন, দ্যাট ইউ উইল বি ফাইন্ডিং বিকজ ইন দ্য এলিপ্টিক পোলারাইজেশন অ্যাকচুয়ালি সিন্স দ্য ইলেকট্রিক ফিল্ড ভেক্টর ইজ ইন দিস প্লেন, সো দেয়ার উইল বি ইট ক্যান বি ব্রোকেন ইন টু টু অর্থোগোনাল কম্পোনেন্টস। ইফ দ্য ম্যাগনিচিউডস অফ দোজ টু কম্পোনেন্টস আর সেম দেন ইট ইজ সার্কুলার, ইফ দে আর নট সেম দেন ইট ইজ এলিপস। সো আই থিঙ্ক that question, oh, there is another thing that if wave is traveling in x direction, then how we find phase difference. So, that you should know, because in the time domain there will be expression that suppose if the wave is traveling in either plus x direction or minus x direction. So, definitely the electric field vector will be in the y z plane, and there the y component of electric field vector E vector, that will then have a y some thing, then some sine or cos, some phase information, plus a z some magnitude, then sine something or cos something, whatever. Now, you find out here that what is the phase. You see that this argument of sine, the whole thing, which is not a function of time. So, this argument you take, then you see the portion which is not a function of time, that will be your delta phi y, that means that is the phase of the y component. And here again you see this argument, you see the portion which is not a function of time, that will be your delta phi z. So, now you will have to find delta phi minus delta z. Is it clear? What is quantum teleportation? These are not concerned with this course. Don't try to have high bombarding things. These are inconsequential in understanding any concepts. How a particle can be transported without any medium? Please go to physics class. Does it require any antenna? I won't answer any of these questions. Don't ask me all these questions. This is not a quiz class, and this is a basic electromagnetics engineering course. Another question I found was very interesting question, and that is really always requires discussion. That is, what is the E plane and H plane? I think the question was that I am confused about the E plane and H plane. If the direction of maximum radiation is at theta is equal to 0, assuming z axis, then which will be the E plane? The student who have asked this question, I appreciate that actually this is always a source of confusion, but I will try to clarify. I don't know whether I will be able to clarify your doubt, but you see that this is the confusion comes because our knowledge in geometry is quite poor. All of us actually in our country, our college school education does not give us enough foundations on geometry things. So, please remember that what is a plane? A plane means there if I have any line, so any two points in the plane, if I connect, it will always give a line. That is the plane. Actually, it is the next higher concept of line, that any two points in a plane, if I connect that, it will be a line. So, to now there can be, if I have two points, if I have two points, I have an unique line, but infinite number of such lines make a plane. But it has been shown in geometry that to uniquely identify a plane, you require two lines. So, if two lines are specified, you can define a plane. So, E plane, its definition is simple. You require two lines. One line is the direction of maximum radiation. So, that is a vector. So, that gives you a line, and Another is, since it is E plane, the E field vector direction, E field direction. These two will give you a plane. Now, similarly, H plane is this same is the maximum direction of radiation. That means basically the main beam direction or the axis of the main beam, and H plane in that time it will be H. This is okay, the definition wise, but when you try to apply, as the your second part says, that how I find, actually you see that if I have a rectangular geometry, Cartesian geometry, finding E field and H field etcetera is not a problem, because we can visualize those things very well. But the whole problem comes if the question, if the actual your source or antenna or the transport system is either in the have a spherical symmetry or have a cylindrical symmetry or any other type of non-Cartesian, non-rectangular symmetry. So, as your question starts, the next part is important, that if I have maximum radiation theta is equal to 0, I will modify your question. I will not take theta is equal to 0. I will say, suppose you know that theta is equal to some constant. Now, theta is equal to constant, what is it? It is not a line. Actually, theta is equal to 0 is a special case where it becomes lines. What is, suppose I am assuming that you have asked the question from the spherical coordinate system. So, in spherical coordinate system, theta is equal to 0 means actually you are talking of z axis. But I want to make it more tough, that theta is equal to constant. Because it can be that theta is equal to constant, like for a current element. We know that maximum direction, maximum radiation direction is theta is equal to 90 degree. So, what is that? So, there can be some antenna where it can be in between. Now, think that what is this? So, if this is ZA, actually theta is equal to constant, this represents what? It represents a cone. It represents a cone. Now, what is the radius of the, what is the, what is the cone say? Ground, what is that thing called? This actually depending on, so here you see theta constant, that means you can have R and phi can vary. So, depending on R, you will have the cone's base of the cone can be as large, but then actually what you are varying here is phi. So, theta is equal to 0 represents this. Now, here actually that means you have a whole half circular cone. Now, there will be an E field vector. So, E field vector can be anything. Let us say that you have found E theta. Now, this is again a problem, that E theta at various points are various things. But I take that, suppose I am talking of this is my far field. So, at this point it is E theta. Bring that E theta here and put it here parallel to it. So, you are having the same E theta. Now, you take any other point on this base and make it parallel. Now, these two you cut it from here. You think of, you have a ice cream cone and there you are having two points and you are, you know the direction from which your knife will go, and you take a cut, that will be a plane. So, this is your E plane. Similarly, if instead of this your E plane was like this, bring it here, take another one, take a cut, that will be your E plane. Similarly, you can do for H plane. Now, that means there are infinite number of E planes for a particular problem also, because my E theta, etc. there. That's why we talk of principally plane. In principally plane, we try to align this plane with one of the Cartesian coordinate systems plane. So, like in case of dipole, you see, we know that maximum radiation takes place. So, let me draw a dipole. That if I have a z axis thing, then and this is the origin. So, I have a dipole here. I know that dipole is has a maximum radiation in this direction. This is basically our y axis direction. And here, what is the maximum E field direction? E field E theta at this point on y axis, it will be in the z direction. That is why we say that in the yz plane. So, yz is a particular or it is a principal E plane, because this plane is aligned with the geometrical plane of the coordinate system. But you can have many other E planes. All E planes are characterized by this, that at that point where in or in that plane the E field vector is lying, and also the your direction of maximum radiation, that is lying. Okay. So, I do not know whether I could just think over, actually these are the new concept, E plane, H plane. But remember one thing, that you have to have the in that plane which you are talking, there you need to have the main beam axis or the direction in which the maximum radiation is taking place and the E field vector. So, they should be part of that plane. So, these two line will always make a plane, and that will be called the E plane. It may not be principal E plane always, but generally we try to express it in terms of principal E planes. I do not know if I have satisfied you. If you can further put your things in forums, I will try to see that. Any other? Another is how to solve assignment questions. Actually, you will see that, please listen to the lectures carefully. In the lectures, some of the concepts are being talked. Now, that you need to do it yourselves. You repeat those things, write those things, write those derivations yourselves, and the time when you will be able to do it without looking at your class notes, after that you will be able to do the assignments clearly, and actually it will require some time. This is not an easy course, and also the material we covered is not very easy. So, it will require some time to get accustomed, but once you have started the beginning, I think with practice, with some more hard work from your side, listening to the lectures very carefully many times, it is always not that by listening once or listening twice you will understand. Gradually you will understand. Also read books. There are two books I am saying. One is Antenna Theory by Balanis, C. Balanis. This book, you will see that I have many concepts I have discussed from this book. And also there is another book. Now, this book is nowadays difficult to get. That is a very good book where lot of mathematics that we have used are taken from that book. It is called Antennas and Radio Wave Propagation by R. E. Collin. it was a McGraw-Hill book. So, also Colin has another very good book called Antenna Theory. It is a big book, Colin and Zucker, that also you can read. And also my advice is, don't read bad books. There are so many bad books. There are so many people who think they know antennas, because in our country everyone thinks he is antenna expert, and there are lot of rubbish things also written. So please don't read those books. Those books may be easier to read, but those are harmful for understanding concepts. Then there was another question which said that, can you please share some basics on designing antennas for real time applications in detail? I say that we have not discussed anything unreal time application. For real time application, I think there is a different meaning for real time application. I don't think the student who has done that question is mean that, but assuming that it is a applications, actually for all applications, whatever you need from antennas, basics that we have covered. So we have not covered anything which can be done by machines and you will just look at. So that was not the thing of course. It is, this whole course was designed so that anyone who masters this concept, you can design any antenna yourself without help of any software or any other thing. Softwares and other things, please remember that the person who designed that, he understands all these concepts. And anyone, any Tom, Dick and Harry can design antennas with using those softwares. Our aim was not to make those Tom, Dick and Harrys, but our aim was to make those persons who can design the softwares, etc., or actual antennas who can design. Okay? So I don't think any other significant questions were there. How to do impedance matching for any slotted structure for wide band? So you can always, the slotted structure, you do the slotted structure's field analysis, and from field analysis you try to find out the circuit equivalent of slotted structure, and the moment you have circuit equivalence, you have its impedance, then you do impedance matching for that. I don't understand how this question came. So impedance matching for and if you want to know impedance matching, in one of my earlier NPTEL lecture, I think building blocks of microwave, building blocks of microwave engineering, impedance matching was covered. For slotted structure, we have shown how to find the fields. Now, that if you have E and H at the slotted structure, you can always find out what is the impedance of that structure. And wide band, etc. Actually, I do not know why you ask this question. These questions are all specific questions. These questions are research questions. These are not basics. That how impedance matching and wide band, what is the connectivity? But if you want to do impedance matching, how to do wide band impedance matching, that you see the NPTEL lecture, earlier lectures. Those are all prerequisite for this antenna course. How directivity is related to polarization? No relation between them. We also have not said any time that they are related. Directivity is a thing that how antenna is in a particular direction, how it is giving power radiation. So it is the directive nature of the antenna. and polarization says that in time domain how the electric field vector is changing with time, what is the locus of the electric field vector in time. So, these two are two different concepts, there is no relation. How can we design a patch antenna to be circularly polarized? Explain your method works physically. How can we design a patch antenna to be circularly polarized? Okay, you join any of our courses, you come to IIT and join the courses, there we will teach. This was not the we did not say that in this course itself we will teach you this thing, that was not part of our course. How to find equivalent circuit for any structure of antenna? I have already said that impedance matching thing, that time I have said the equivalent circuit for any structure, actually that is not only antenna, for any structure you find out the E field and H field, you take the ratio, that is the impedance of that field, that structure. So, by that you can always find out what is the equivalent structure. How polarization changes in an anisotropic medium. Yes, it is a good one. High polarization changes in an anisotropic medium. In an anisotropic medium, so in various directions I have got, so first let us see that if I have a homogeneous medium and in that medium, if I have an electric field, external electric field like this, then the polarization, that also the polarized field, that also, or the polarization of the field, that also either in this direction or opposite to this direction. But in an anisotropic medium, so suppose here I have this direction of P, but here I may have this direction of P, here I may have some other direction of P, that is anisotropic. So that is why the net polarization of the whole medium, that is different. And that is not collinear with the applied electric field, that is the only difference from a thing. So, please, antenna's polarization and this polarization, these two are two different things. It is good that you have brought this question. Actually, here the polarization you are seeing, this is actually, if you have a non-conduct or if you do not have free charges, then there are bound charges, all matter in life have bound charges, and if you have an external electric field, then the bound charges, they reorient themselves, the net effect of that macroscopically is called polarization vector. Now, anisotropy etcetera, they affect that polarization vector, that means if I have an external electric field, whether that macroscopic addition of all the microscopic polarization things, that will be collinear or not, that is determined by whether the medium is isotropic. If it is anisotropic, this P has a changed one. Now, but here what we are talking of, or what polarization we said, that was about that what is the locus of the electric field vector of a wave. Now, these two are two completely different concepts, this polarization. I actually have not said it any time in my lecture that these two are different. Actually, these two polarizations are two different polarization. One is materials polarization. So, that was in EM theory we teach, and this polarization what we said that is to give an idea that how electric field vector is behaving in time domain. So, these two are non-related. So, here how polarization changes in an anisotropic medium, if this polarization you said about material polarization I explained, and about antenna there is no connection, antenna or wave there is no concept of this polarization here. For a dual band antenna with 40% fractional bandwidth, what could be best configuration? Slot patch, I don't know any of these. What is SAR, what is FCC limit on SAR, how can I improve the SAR? Why you ask these questions? Probably you know lot of SAR etcetera. This is, we have not discussed anything about synthetic aperture radar here. So, why I will answer your question, you tell me. You are wasting time. When will, if you go to any radar course or you go to any signal processing course, there SAR etcetera is taught. So, what is SAR? SAR is synthetic aperture radar, but how far it satisfies your knowledge, I do not know. What is FCC limit on SAR? These are all specific questions, these are all some what I will say that some information. We do not deal with information, we are teachers, we try to say you how to see the basics of the thing, these are not basics. SAR basics is an important thing, when we will you see probably our next course will be on radar, that time we will have the course on the theme, one week theme will be on synthetic aperture radar. What is RCS? Again the same thing, that these are all radar concepts. What is RCS? What shapes and materials are good or bad for RCS? Again, probably you work on RCS, your research is on RCS. So, you see North's book, there it is written. What is RCS actually in Fries transmission equation? Probably we have talked about, I do not remember. Actually, RCS is you can think that electrically the size of any target as seen by radar, that is called radar cross section. Okay. The further of this will you can see in any radar course, these things are there. You see Skolnick's book, or there is a whole book by Knott where whole RCS is described, you can consult that book. How dipole bandwidth can be improved? You see that dipole is a resonant structure, it resonates when its size is there, then it resonates, and you see that any resonance means that any resonance means I have suddenly the energy that was getting stored in the structure or thing that is getting released. So, with frequency any resonance structure have these. So, you see the bandwidth will be from here, if I look at two points which are some criteria wise some 3 dB or 10 dB down. So, this is the bandwidth. Now, any resonating structure will have narrow bandwidth. Now, if you want to improve it, you make this flatter. That means, make it more non-resonant. Actually, that is the way any wideband antenna from dipole is utilized, that you try to have or you try to damp that resonance. How the resonance can be damped? Basically, you insert some resistance into the picture. You know that if you have a LC circuit, you can have, if you have an LC circuit, you can have a very sharp resonance, but if you with that if you have either a series or parallel resistance, then this shape will be changed and it will be flatter. So that is the way you can improve the bandwidth, but definitely you will lose the efficiency of the thing. That's why a very important parameter of radar antenna is the radiation efficiency. So radiation efficiency will suffer if you want to improve the bandwidth of dipole. When a vertically polarized antenna receives the wave transmitted from 45 degree polarized antenna, what will be the loss? Okay, so you again you see that you are following double standard. In somewhere you are writing vertically polarized. Now please tell what is your reference to the angle. Now if vertically polarized doesn't have any reference, so you will also have to talk. So from any particular reference you find out the polarization of the vertically polarized antenna. So that means your receiving antenna's polarization, you draw a vector that is called AR, let us say, and the wave transmitted from a 45 degree polarized antenna. So you also find out the vector, that is unit vector that is representing the polarization of the incoming wave. So let me call it AT. So now the loss, that will be nothing but this AT dot AR, and since this is loss in power, so this will be magnitude square. So that we have already said in the polarization loss, that you find out the polarizations, and if the polarizations, the two unit vectors which are characterizing those polarizations, they are dot product you take. If the dot product is 1, you do not have any loss. If the dot product is less than 1, then you have that amount of loss. Only take the square, because these are the field quantities, these unit vectors are corresponding to the fields, whereas power loss is in terms of power. So that is why there is a square. Suppose antenna radiation propagated through two different mediums like air and water, then how power and polarization affect the receiver end? Propagated through two different mediums like air and water. Okay, so how power? Actually, you see that every medium that will have some epsilon, that will have some mu, and that will have some sigma. So you will have to find that, and based on that, you can always find out what is the reflection coefficient. Also, you need to find out what is the polarization of the waves. Based on that, you can find the reflection coefficient. So from that, you can find out that how much power is reflected. So by making a power balance, you can find how much power has gone to the next medium. In that medium, again, you will, when it will leave that medium, that time again, you will have to find the reflection coefficient. So finally, how much power has gone? So now we will arrive at that after passing through those two mediums, what will be the power, that you can find out. So power is a scalar concept, whereas in case of polarization, you will have to see that when you are hitting the first interface, what was the incoming wave's polarization, and then when it goes to the second medium, if what is the polarization there. Generally, if there is a simple medium, then the polarization will remain unchanged, but if there are some other antennas etcetera you are talking, then there will be, and that antenna is aligned at a different way, then there will be thing. For simple material, simple means that homogeneous, isotropic and linear, the polarization for the material won't change, but if there is non-simple mediums, then the polarization may be changed, because that time the epsilon, mu, etcetera, they won't be simply scalars, etcetera, they will be vectors or tensors. So, depending on that, the polarization may get also affected. Please discuss about the planar monopole antenna basics. Have I discussed in that case? Planar monopole antenna basics. Planar antennas are nothing but all the basics of all antennas are same. There is planar antenna and other antennas, there is no difference. And monopole antenna we have discussed. Now, planar, if you want to make, that requires that you need to understand that what is the technology, what is, whether it is microstrip or whether it is what is that slot line, etcetera. So that thing is a technology thing that you need to come to join our MTech courses and study. Otherwise, the monopole and other things we have discussed. Please explain about surface current density with respect to a receiving antenna. Surface current density with respect to a receiving antenna, it is not with respect to a receiving antenna or anything. Anywhere, if you have a field, if you want to instead want to work with current density, you can do that by using equivalent theorem, etcetera. So, you have, please refer to my lectures where how to find that equivalent current density, we have seen that. That you revise, you will understand whatever we have talked there. I think that is sufficient for your throughout life to understand what is the surface current density from fields. What are the major details should we observe from co and cross polarization plots? Major details that we will observe will all the antenna basics that we have said, all that should be observed for all the antennas. Actually, always we do not observe all the details, but major details that you should have from any plots, that always will be having all those things. Those all the things that we discussed under antenna basics, these are all the vital parameters from which you will get idea of the performance of the antenna. You see, I am not here to reply to all this. Frequency reconfiguration and beam steering antennas are different or not? We have not discussed beam steering, we have not discussed frequency reconfiguration, etcetera. These are all higher concepts. First you learn this concept, first you learn antennas, then all antennas, these are special applications, beam steering, frequency reconfiguration. So, that thing and how to achieve it, that you do your research, you will then understand. But before that, you learn this, this is a fundamental course. So, if you do not understand this course on antenna, do not think that you will be thinking of going to this beam steering antennas and frequency reconfiguration. चलो 45 मिनट हो गए जी It's a good question. How equivalent radiation pattern be obtained if different type of antennas are arranged in certain geometry, like whatever you said, but my point is, yes, the answer is pattern multiplication. So, you consider that similar, like you said, two half wavelength dipole antenna. So, they are in some fashion they are arranged, you find the array factor for them, you know the element pattern of half wave dipole. So, you know the radiation pattern of that array, and then there are two quarter wavelength or an vertex of square something. So, that means you have some quarter wavelength antenna in some fashion. So, find out the radiation pattern for that. These two radiation pattern you multiply, that will give you the total pattern. Good. What is the minimum distance between two antenna that if they are kept, their radiation pattern will not affect? No, always it will affect. Always it will affect. Now, the question is that for simple calculations, we neglect it. When you will go to higher or when you want to refine your calculations results, you need to take them. So, any two antennas, if wherever you keep, they always affect each other. So, what you will have to do, you will find out the mutual effect. That means, if I have an antenna here, if I have an antenna here, now this antenna in isolation, how it radiates, we know. So, you can find out what are the E and H fields for this. Similarly, this one, if what are the E and H fields everywhere, you can find out. Also, you find out that this antenna will produce a current, surface current on this antenna. So, that will again radiate, and what will be the field. This antenna will also produce a surface current here, and that will produce a field. Here we are using all the concepts of Huygens secondary source, etcetera. So, there are primary sources, two primary sources, there will be also two secondary sources which are due to the mutual effect. The total effect is sum of these four effects. Difference between the S parameters of active and passive RF devices. Yes, S parameters, active and passive. So, this question actually, you can see my earlier NPTEL lecture on design of amplifiers, etcetera. Basically, S parameters for passive device means that your any reflection coefficient, it cannot be, its magnitude cannot be greater than 1. So, all S parameters, it should be within a Smith chart. But for passive devices, that is no more true, because they are already generating energy. So, that is why their S parameters magnitude, that can be more than 1. So, they can go outside of the Smith chart. But this question was not related to antenna, anyhow I answered it. How to calculate the feed line width and length for the aperture coupled patch antenna? Yes, you read, there are various good papers on this, how to calculate. This is a research topic, find out. You see, all the answers cannot be obtained from me. I also do not know most of these answers. So, you read, there are lot of things on IEEE AP mega transaction. There are lot of papers on this. Also, these are classical things. So, aperture coupled patch antenna. So, there are lots of papers on this. Those papers you read, you will find the answer. What will be the radiation pattern of in dipole antenna arranged along the line. Actually, that was the whole thing that we discussed in our array class. So, that find out what is the each antenna's field, then since they are also arranged in a particular fashion, there will be an extra phase due to that. So, that incorporate those phases. So, the total sum is the superposition of all these individual thing, and that gives you the total radiation pattern. This thing we discussed fully in array antenna basics. How to reduce mutual coupling in arrays? Actually, mutual coupling we did not talk about, but mutual coupling is an important thing. So, as I think you have noticed in the previous, there was a question on two dipoles. So, how to reduce mutual coupling means this one is producing a surface current here. So, that surface current either there are various ways by which you can cut this reduce this surface currents, induce surface currents, and then whatever has been induced, stop that from radiating back. That means, the secondary source radiation that you try to correct. These are the ways by which mutual coupling can be reduced. When to use dB and dBi while mentioning gain of patch antenna? Actually, gain of patch antenna, always you see that our, not only patch antenna, any antenna, our basic reference is, the basic definition of gain is with respect to an isotropic radiator. So, that is why always it is better to use dBi as the thing, because actual unit of A is dBi, because with respect to an isotropic we are always saying an isotropic radiator has a gain of 0 dB. So, it is better always use dBi to avoid confusion. Hmm.